Coming up on the Men at the Movies podcast, we deep dive into the world of Taken. We discuss how we frequently act like Kim towards God. We look at him as super strict, a buzzkill. We're willing to sever relationship if we don't get what we want. Thankfully, our Father pursues us with a committed, relentless purpose, willing to go through anything to restore our relationship. But we aren't rescued to be a consumer in the audience. We've been rescued in order to discover what makes our heart come alive and partner in the mission. Join us as we discover God's truth in this movie.
The movies and stories we love are gateways to see ourselves and God in new ways.
Every great story borrows its power from a larger story. The story that's written on our hearts and woven into the fabric of our very being.
If you are looking for ransom, I can tell you I don't have money. But what I do have are a very particular set of skills. Skills I have acquired over a very long career. Skills that make me a nightmare for people like you.
Hello and welcome to the Men at the Movies podcast. My name is Paul McDonald, and joining me, not from France, not from Albania, is my buddy Britt. Once again from Hotlanta. How you doing, man?
I'm warm. But I'm doing well. Had a lot of encouraging things happen this week. Good conversations, good things moving forward as we go through transition and networking and just getting clarity on where God's taking more me. I mean, you know, my life isn't.
I see what you did there. You're being taken.
Taken. You know, my wife, her job isn't changing, and my kids, their school. I mean, you know, there's a lot of our life that isn't changing, in a sense. But you know, new church, new roles for me, and different things, and of course that does affect our family because we like to be together in things. So
yeah.
But there's a lot of encouraging things happening with that. New book is out,
awesome.
And at least some people are excited about
it.
We were reborn for this, the Jesus model for living heaven on earth. And there's only one person who knows what heaven is like. And he's the only one who can tell us and show us. And so we have to look at how he did it when he came to earth in the full authority of God while being a human being. So we do that. I do that in the book using the framework of the story of Lazarus as kind of three principles within the story of Lazarus, as we look at what it means to live the resurrected life while we are here on earth. And so it's gotten a lot of great reviews, a lot of great endorsements from people that I highly respect, like Alan Arnold and Bishop Garland Hunt, and just other people that Bill Myers, who, you know, again, some people may not know these people, but they are people that I respect, and they are people that are successful in their own ways and have worked really hard to do a lot of really cool stuff. So, anyway, I'm excited about it. We'll see if anyone but my mom buys a copy, but no. A couple of people have bought copies, so so we'll see. We'll see how things go. So, it's good.
So, check that out. We were reborn for this. There'll be a link in the show notes and on our website, menatthemovies.com/podcast/taken, because that's where this one's going to be found.
Taken.
Because obviously we're talking about Taken, and it's interesting as you were describing Jesus and his power to share what heaven looks like, what the kingdom of God looks like. He's the only one who's really seen it, who's been on this earth. And over the last couple of weeks, I read this article in the Washington Post by a woman who said, men are lost because basically we don't have a map. In our culture today, it's very difficult for society to say, this is what a good man looks like. And so they're drawn to extreme caricatures and stuff. And I was like, yeah, I actually agree with what you're saying. But I disagree that we don't have a roadmap, because just like he's the roadmap to heaven, Jesus is the roadmap to masculinity and what a real man looks like and how a man navigates the world around him. And then, you know, the whole reason our podcast exists is because we want to talk about how we see that in the movies. And so today we're taking, we're taking Taken. And specifically, we're going to look at how many times we are like Kim, the daughter. We're going to look at how Liam Neeson's character, Brian, is a picture of the father's heart and pursuit for us. But then wrapping it up, because, you know, it has to be somewhat practical. And what does that mean? And it means that we're rescued, we're saved for a purpose. We're not just, it's not just, just so we can sit back and ride ponies all day. There's actually a purpose for our rescue, for our salvation. So that is our nutshell version, our synopsis of our conversation. This is me in a nutshell.
This is me in a nutshell.
Well, you know, an acorn.
Wayne's World, people. Yeah,
an acorn is just an oak tree, really, in a nutshell.
Dad jokes. We don't have the bourbon guys on here. Yeah, we gotta make up for the
JB and Fancy Rob when you need them. So
drinking bourbon—that's where they are.
Yeah, probably. So, if you haven't seen this, you probably live under a rock. But came out in 2008. Liam Neeson was the main character, sort of reestablished himself as an action movie guy, even though he's like in his 60s or something. Him and Tom Cruise still killing it. You like that, huh?
I did.
He is super old. Like he's got the, obviously they touched up his hair so it's darker, so he looks younger, but.
Well, yeah, kind of looks younger. So I'm laughing because my son the other day was like, where did all the action heroes go? I said, they're 80 and they're still making movies. Right. Like
Harrison Ford, Tom Cruise, Liam Neeson.
These guys, we haven't really found a lot of new ones. There's a couple, you know, Chris Pratt kind of has done a couple, and there's a couple that are out there, but we also don't have the culture of big blockbuster movies like we used to. And it's all about name recognition. And so it's hard to do something new to get that name recognition. I mean, I don't think people realize how rare John Wick is.
Yeah.
You know, the fact that it just came out of nowhere without hardly any sort of, you know, marketing or anything and blew up like it did. But I think Taken was similar. I don't remember a whole lot of, there's some marketing around Taken, but Taken kind of came out of nowhere. From what I remember, it was like, this is just another kind of action flick. It's got Liam Neeson in it, which was a little weird at the time.
Yeah.
Because you're like, wasn't he in the Sword movie and he was Scottish or something?
Like Rob Roy, you know, or something, wasn't it?
It's a great movie, by the way. And he's a phenomenal actor, and he did a great job as Qui-Gon Jinn and one of the few highlights of that movie. And so as we look at him, it's like, it's not super outside of, but this definitely does put a shift in Liam Neeson's career, because he's done about 80 of these movies now, not just Taken, but there's been like two or three other sort of little series of action movies that he's done since Taken, which is essentially the same story. He's just a kick butt dude. And somebody made the mistake of pissing him off. But this is a great flick, man. I remember seeing this in the theater and just like everyone else, when he gets on that phone and lays it down to that dude, you're like, holy crap, this is about to go down, you know? And that's what you want in an action movie. This right. is what you want. Obviously the sex trafficking was a fairly unique idea at the time. That was a fairly unique take on, I keep using the word take, perspective for an action movie. It wasn't drugs. It wasn't some of these other things, you know, or terrorism. It was specifically sex trafficking. And I just want to let everybody know that sex trafficking is a real thing. And you can think what you want about whatever movie that comes out. But when this movie came out in 2008,
yeah,
I had been in Korea for 4 years. And we knew sex trafficked women, like, who were basically stuck where they were. And but they were from Russia or whatever. And there was I'm not going into all the details, but I'm saying there is an organization that has this going on in the world. And of course, it also includes almost 2 million children by the UN report. So you can feel what you want about certain movies, but this movie really kind of brought this out.
Yeah.
And in a way that hadn't really been done yet, from my recollection, at least.
The synopsis of the movie is Brian Mills, Liam Neeson's character, has a daughter. Daughter goes to Paris. She gets taken. Chaos ensues. He rescues her. That's it in a nutshell. Once again, this is all about the nutshells. But it's interesting, as I watch this, and we took these, but like, we don't normally go into a movie, at least I don't, knowing the angle that we want to take. Like, I texted you even before we went into this movie. It's like, we are going to talk about how this is a reflection of the father's heart and pursuit of us as his children.
Yep.
When you do that, it really opens up some interesting concepts in the first 20 minutes of the movie. You know, it's interesting because it opens up, and I want us to try to look at it from Kim's perspective, his daughter. As she looks at who Brian is, her dad apparently has been sort of behind the scenes. He's been off doing other stuff. You know, he's like a CIA agent. But the interesting thing was, when he's describing it to her, he says he's a preventer. He prevents bad things from happening.
Yeah.
But the way that it shows you, doesn't tell you, it shows you, he looks boring. You see him. You know, he does a lot of research before getting a karaoke machine. He is meticulous in how he folds and wraps wraps the present for Kim. And then when he goes, he's like, I here I am. I'm giving you a karaoke machine because your stepdad, who in this case we're going to call it the false father, is offering a horse. He's like, ooh, a horse. And Lenore, the ex-wife, She looks at Brian. She's like, she wanted to be a singer when, you know, she's 12. She's 17 now. She's growing up, right? It's all about growing up, being mature. I mean, if you really want to super spiritualize it, you could say it's all about doing what's right, learning what's right and wrong, learning what life is about. That's what her mother is focused on, getting her to experience what life is like. Interesting pursuit, because they live a life of luxury, comfort. You know, they have chauffeurs, they have maids, they have, you know, very, very large. There's a sense of largesse to it. And so what you don't see is the behind the scenes. They don't know who Brian is because he was off fighting for their country. And it came to a point where a few of his buddies show up to rehash old times. They ask, how is it going? Because Brian got out of that life in order to pursue a relationship with her, with his daughter, to reestablish, to know her. And one of the questions one of them asks as they're sitting around, they said, does she appreciate the fact you've given up your life to be with her? Which I thought, again, if you're looking at this dynamic as a God, the Father, pursuit of us. That's an interesting question, but I'm getting ahead of myself because I want to focus on Kim. And Kim, she kind of whispers in his ear, yeah, I still want to be a singer. Don't tell mom. She says, I got to grow up or whatever. As again, she gets a pony basically for her birthday, like any 5-year-old spoiled brat does. I don't know. I don't know any kids who got horses for their birthday, but... But she sees him as being mostly gone, strict, has a lot of rules, has a lot of conditions, someone that she can't go to and be honest with. And so they finally go and she calls Brian. She calls her. Kim calls her dad, says, hey, let's have lunch. And just like most of us, when we show up, when we actually want to talk to our father, it's usually because we want something. And in this case, she wants to go to Paris with her friend to do. She says they're going to just stay and go to museums. We're going to get into what actually is going on later. But this conversation, they're in this cafe between Brian and Kim and Lenore, their original family. Again, if you look at it from what Kim says, the way that she looks at it, and how that is frequently the way we look at God, I just thought it was super interesting.
Dad, please. I really, really want to go. And they've got this like sick apartment overlooking the river.
Just you and Amanda.
And her cousins.
Don't make a big deal out of this, Brian. Just sign the paper. What?
I'm not comfortable with this.
Dad.
I don't think a 17-year-old should be traveling alone.
I'm not going to be alone.
Two 17-year-olds.
Amanda's 19.
How about this? How about if I go along? You won't even know I'm there. I'm very good at being invisible.
As you've so amply demonstrated for most of her life. Just sign the paper, Brian.
I'll think about it.
Boy, Brian, everyone at this table knows what that means.
Hey, Kimmy. There's something else.
I don't want anything else.
Kim.
I don't get you.
What?
You sacrificed our marriage in the service of the country. You made a mess of your life in the service of your country. Can't you sacrifice just a little this one time for your own daughter?
I would sacrifice anything for her.
Then what's your problem?
I'm not comfortable putting my daughter at risk.
Putting our daughter at risk by going to Paris? You're pathetic.
So there's a couple of things leading up to this as far as how he is looked at. And let's just say on a human level, it's absolutely possible that men can get involved in their work and not be present for a number of different reasons. And so I don't want to excuse that as if that's okay for men to do. But on the other hand, if we're going to look at this, try to see some spiritual parallels here. It is difficult to live with God on mission when you just want a normal American life. In fact, I'm going to say it's impossible to live with God if you just want a normal American life. He's out preventing bad people from doing bad things. He's out rescuing people. Now, I'm not saying in the movie Brian would have let his wife and daughter go with him on any of these excursions. I'm just saying that it is difficult to live with a God who is always on mission. You feel left behind in some ways. And in some ways, you are left behind if what you want is a normal American life. And God is trying to take you on mission in general. This is just a general statement. And so for her, it was difficult because later on, she talks about it again in the airport. I was waiting on a phone call that never came, that you weren't coming home and I didn't hear from you. And I think a lot of times we want God to kind of chase us a little bit. And in God's mind, he's on the move. And he's not chasing us in a certain sense, because he married us. He's like, I want you, like, we're partners here. So, again, I don't want to dismiss the fact that some men do, you know, are not present as much as they should be, and they get too involved in their work for all sorts of reasons. So, therefore, the daughter has been influenced by the mom. Because the mom, obviously, at some point, divorces Brian. And then turns around and marries a super wealthy guy who can give her all the comforts of whatever.
Make her feel safe and secure.
Make her feel safe and secure. But
emphasis on feel.
In a worldly sort of wealthy sense. But the dream is sacrificed because, again, there's distraction. It's a pony. It's not really the stepdad, I'm assuming, loves the stepdaughter, Kim, but he doesn't really know her. He doesn't know the cry of her heart to be is childish, or the mom thinks it's childish. Maybe she's influenced the Stewart dude, who, by the way, is a creepy actor. Like, that actor, he might be the nicest guy in the world in person, but whenever I see him, he's like a character actor. Whenever I see him in anything, he's just a creep. He just looks creepy, even if he's supposed to be like a good guy. And by the way, Kim is played by Maggie Grace, who was in Lost, I'm pretty sure. And yeah, so they had a decent cast for its time. So I'm saying all that to say that when we look at God, oftentimes we are thinking about, how do I make this life fun for me? And God is out rescuing people because he knows there is great evil in the world. And that is a hard thing to know when you, it's easy to not know that when you are surrounded by opulence and wealth. It's easy to kind of cushion yourself from those ideas. But when you're out on mission, you realize that there's a lot of brokenness in this world. There's a lot of brokenness out there. And the Father knows that there's a lot of brokenness in this world. And so when he sees his daughter go, oh, yeah, we're just... He goes, I don't know. There's an enemy out there. No, it's not that big of a deal. You worry too much. You're just about rules and regulations. So we see God as a legalist instead of someone who's trying to help us. And then also we do to God what she does. Like you said, I think that was really good, where she went, she's just calling him. He's excited to just be with her.
I finally got lunch. Just me and Kimmy.
He's excited to just be with her.
And his buddies are all excited for him.
And she's just calling him, like you said, because she wants something. But she couches it in a way that she thinks he'll like. And we do the same thing with God.
But I'm going to go to museums. I didn't know you were into art.
We do the same thing. God, if you let me win the lottery, I will give, right? But we don't want to win the lottery because we want to give money. We want to win the lottery because we think we will be safe and secure and not have to work and not have to worry about bills. And that, right? Like that, really, let's just be honest. That's why we want to win the lottery. And we say, well, and then there will be plenty left over, Father. I'll give millions away, right? But the Father knows at the heart is selfishness. That's the root of it. And so he knows that. And so he's like, I love you too much. I'm not going to give you that.
Right. And that was an interesting thing where she's like, you sacrificed your family, our marriage for the country. Can't you sacrifice a little for your daughter? And he said, I would sacrifice anything for her. An uncaring father is like, sure, go there. That sounds cool. See you when you get home. And the picture is when at the very end, talked about, I don't want to put my daughter at risk. What, like for her, for Lenore, the concept of her going to Paris, how is that putting her at risk? You're pathetic. And that's how the world couches us. You believe the Bible? That's pathetic. The whole framework of actually believing in something other than ourselves, other than what society teaches us to think, and actually is like, no, I actually believe something, and it may not agree with what you believe, but that doesn't make me pathetic. But in today's society, just disagreeing makes you an enemy. Heaven forbid you know, you disagree on something, suddenly you're, and it doesn't matter what. And I used to teach my, tell my nursing students, I was like, look, my wife's a vegetarian. She does not eat ribs, barbecue, brisket, steaks, hamburgers, hot dogs. She will, but they're all plant-based stuff. And I was like, if I'm going to disagree with my wife, who I love more than any other person in this entire world, I'm going to disagree with a lot more people than I'm going to agree with. And if I treat them, be like, oh, you don't believe what I believe, you're pathetic, then that's a quick way to shut down a conversation. But I think we approach God that way. Like you just said, of legalistic rules, responsibilities, conditions. We think he's there to be a buzzkill, to keep us from having a good time. And what you see in that moment, he said, when he said, I've got this other thing for you.
Good.
Where she runs off. She's like, this is all I wanted. I just wanted to go play in Paris. But we'll find out in just a moment that she's actually not planning on staying in Paris. She's going to follow you two around. And you pointed this out ahead of time. She wanted to go follow a band and be in an audience.
Right.
Whereas, what does she want to be? She wants to be a singer. That's what that's what Brian knows, is she wants to be a singer. He did a security detail for a pop star. And actually, you know, through the course of it, the woman gave him her voice coach, her marketer, said, look, if she's any good, the voice coach will tell her. And then the marketing person will take care of her. She's going to become who she longs to be. Like, that was in this moment, that was the father's offer. The father's offer was voice lessons, marketing guy, relationship with the biggest pop star in the, you know, it's basically Taylor Swift or Beyonce today. And she says, I don't want that. I want to go sit in an audience. I want to go follow a band around. And because you didn't give me what I want, I'm going to storm off. And that's what happened to C.S. Lewis. When he was younger, his mom got cancer. He prayed that she would get healed, and she did. The cancer came back years later. He prayed that she would get healed, and she didn't. So he said, I don't believe in God. He spent decades as an atheist. Many people, that's what happens. I prayed to God, and my marriage fell apart. My partner died. My kid died. All these things where we're like, no, this is the one thing I wanted. I wanted to go to Paris.
Yeah, I think it goes beyond that. I think that's true. But this isn't like she asked him for something and like they're like something, you know, something bad did happen. But this is more like, God, I want, this is what I want because I think it's fun. I want to marry this person. I want to have this type of relationship. But God is such a fuddy-duddy, or whatever, you know, whatever term you want to use. He's not going to let me have sex before marriage. And so, what's the big deal? What's the big deal? He's not going to let me do this.
You're pathetic.
He's so puritanical and legalistic and Christians, and it's like, but what we see is, or what the enemy and the world try to highlight to us is, did God really say that you couldn't eat this tree? Mm-hmm. Did God really say that? I mean, well, yeah. Oh, what? You know, so God doesn't want you to have fun. I was like, okay. But really, God, it wasn't that God, yes, God said, don't eat of that tree, but right next to it was the tree of life. So yes, God says no to some things because he has something better in mind. He's mm-hmm. not saying no because he doesn't want you to have fun. He's saying no to that because he knows this will actually satisfy you even more. And so therefore, what we have to learn is, as disappointing as it is sometimes when God doesn't give us what we want, we have to say, wait a minute. Well, maybe God has something better in mind, because God loves me and wants what is best for me. And so therefore, but if my only focus is, okay, I want this one thing, and if I don't get this one thing, then God is,
it's true. We're over.
But because she never even heard the other option. She never even had a chance to listen to it. And he ends up giving in and signing the paper. And in the movie, she lied to him and the whole thing. But listen, God will not force you. He will say no, but he will let you chase after what you want, what you think you want. He'll let you do it. And what makes him amazing, as we get into the movie more, is even though you get exactly what he says you would get, he still goes to hell for you. He still goes into the darkest places for you. Even though he could easily have said, she deserves everything she gets. I told her, I warned her. She lied to me. She deserves this. But and maybe on some level that's true. But what he does is he doesn't even bring that up. He's like, I'm going to go get her. He loves you that much.
And I want to touch on this one idea, because she storms off, right? When she says, this is the only thing I want. And how often in prayers are so much of our speeches to God. But in those moments where we are disappointed, where we don't get what we want, it's really important to take some time and listen to God. Say, well, wait, what? You said no here. I lost my job, lost my house, car, kids, marriage, dreams, whatever. I'm super disappointed. But are you willing to listen? Are you willing to stay and say, okay, you have something else? Because she refused, she left. And who's to say what would have happened if she, I mean, obviously she doesn't get taken, but if she had listened to the offer, would that have brought her to life even more? When she's like, oh, I don't even want to go to Paris and watch you two. I want to go learn how to be on a stage, to be the one singing and leading the audience. We get stuck. Just like she does. Because she doesn't say this. She says she's going to go to museums, all this. He takes her to the airport. He discovers a map. And this is where her true heart is revealed, but not to him. Her mom was complicit in this. And the other part is, so many times as dads, when our kids screw up, we really want to say, I told you this would happen. I told you this would happen. You're on your own. Good luck. And I know people that have that's happened with kids, with, you know, high school daughters that got pregnant and they kick them out or they don't speak to them for years, decades. And the devastation that happens if their son comes out and that says they're gay. Well, you're not living here anymore. And basically, all the things they were afraid of happening actually happen from the kid's perspective. And so on this next scene, they're at the airport. He discovers her true intention to follow you two around. He asks Lenore, did you know about this? And she actually is sort of complicit, aiding. And again, it mirrors our own false sense of security when interacting with the world we live in.
Lenore, do you know about this? She's not just going to Paris.
I know.
She lied to me.
Yes, because she can't be honest with you.
Why? What are you talking about?
Your rules and conditions.
What is this?
It's you two's European tour dates.
She's following a rock band around Europe.
All the kids do. Stuart got her the tickets. We've arranged for her to stay in the best hotels.
Best hotels? You know, you live in your little bubble here behind your wall with your maids, chauffeurs, and servants. You have no idea what the world is like.
Yes, and neither will she, unless she goes out and experiences it. Don't you tell me I don't know what the world's like. For 5 years, I waited for a phone call that didn't come for weeks at a time. For a knock on the door telling me there'd be no calls anymore. Listen, I know you moved here to build some sort of relationship with Kimmy, but you're not going to do that by smothering her. Let her live, or I promise you'll lose her.
And so many times we take that approach with God. I know what life is like. I know what it's like to, you know, and what she describes is nothing to what he's seen. The truth of the world that he lived in. As he says, the preventing bad things from happening. He knew the bad things that could happen. For her, the worst thing is getting a call that her husband wasn't home, wasn't coming back. And I'm not saying that's not a bad phone call, but she never actually got that call. She was just afraid of it. So she was afraid of what was happening, was the world she lived in. She does live in a bubble, and so do we. We live in the bubble of, we think, like you were saying earlier, we think that mission means I've got to become a missionary. I got to go live in Africa. I got to go live in South America. I got to go give up all my comforts. What is God going to make me give up? And so we are hesitant to go all in with him.
And that's why you have to not shut God down. You have to do what you said earlier. You have to listen. You have to listen because you say, okay, God, maybe you have something better for me. All right. So a couple of things here. First of all, think of how insulting it is. This is the prodigal son moment. Think of how insulting it is that his little girl looks at him. He's given up all that. He's given up a career. He's given up. He's living here. He's not making as much money as he could. He lives in kind of, and it's not a, look, they're showing the contrast, right? The stepdad and the ex-wife and they live in a mansion. He lives in a decent apartment, right? But he's given all this stuff up for her, and she looks at him. She says, "This is all I want. This thing is all I want." And she's willing to sever relationship with her true father for an object, for something, a ticket. Something. That's the prodigal son moment. I want my inheritance now. I wish you were dead and you just give me your stuff. I want, this is transactional. And so the first step is realizing relationship with my father is already winning. That's already enough. That's already enough that my father is willing to do what he does. Now, she didn't know that, and she needed to see that. She needed to learn the hard way that her father would sacrifice anything for her, would give his life for her. She needed to see that because, as we talked about before, we started recording at the end of the movie, it's almost like she's surprised you came for me, because she was living transactionally. He was not living transactionally. He was living for her heart. I'm going to give her the best thing for her heart, which is a karaoke machine in his mind, right? It seems cheesy, right, or childish, but he was giving her in his mind the best thing for his heart. And that's what our father does. That's what our father does. He's more interested in what makes our heart come alive than what all the other kids are doing, which, by the way, is a lie. I know no person, and I've known some rich people in my life. I've known no person who has followed a band around in Europe. I've known no person to do that. Now, I might know of a few adults who have gone to several shows in the Southeast of a band that they might like, where they're like an obscure band. They're like $20 a ticket. But I don't know anybody who like has more than one ticket for U2 or something, right? I mean, right. Like, what do I mean all the kids are doing this? No, they're not. And that's a lie, number one. And so that's another part of this, is we have to stop with this fear of missing out.
Look what they have.
If you look what they have, and God's like, look what I have.
First of all, you have me, and within me is all the opportunity you need for your heart. Because your stepfather, your false father, the world, will never know your heart the way I do. Even your mother, I'm not saying moms don't know your heart, okay? I'm just saying in the movie, even this worldly idea, they don't know your heart. I know your heart, and I'm trying to get you there. And so she needed to see that he was going to go to into the bowels of hell, like just as Jesus went into, you know, it's more, it depends on how you read the scripture, but for the sake of argument, right, the legend is that he went into hell with the and set the captives free, right?
Yeah.
But that's what he does. When we are in sin and separate, and we have separated ourselves from God, and by the way, the root of that separation is a transactional attitude. The root of our separation from God is a transactional attitude. And so therefore, when we get stuck in sin and we're enslaved, God has to go there with us. He has to go, and that's what he did. He sent his son to the world. The world is going to die. It's doomed. And so God sent his son into that place. And it was it wasn't a mansion's, right? It was right. A cave or all that stuff. Like he sent his son into the very bowels of hell to take those keys and loosen the captives. And I said this yesterday, where I was talking, I said, you know, when Jesus, I know you surprised you, I was talking yesterday. Anyway, so yesterday when I was talking to a friend of mine, we were having coffee in the morning, a pastor friend. And we were talking about some of this stuff. And I said, look, if the gospel doesn't set captives free, it's not the gospel. Because when they asked Jesus, are John sent us, are you the one? He said, tell them the lame walk. Tell them the blind see. Tell them the poor have the gospel preached to them. Like, if this doesn't make sense to the poor in our communities, if this doesn't help them and give them hope, then it's not the gospel. Like, so this is what he does. This is who he is. He's going into these places. And, you know, the rest of the movie is after he figures it out, is not a judgment on his part, not condemnation, not an I told you so. It's a complete act of self-sacrifice and love.
I would definitely want to talk about, how would you describe his pursuit? Brian's pursuit of Kim, and how that parallels God's pursuit of us. But first, I wanted to hit what you were just talking about, how when she sees her friend get taken across this amazing apartment, and he's telling her what to do. He knows what's about to happen because it's his worst fear. And I'm not saying that when Adam and Eve sinned, that was God's worst fear, because he knew that was going to happen when he created them in the first place.
Yep.
But at the same time, just like you were saying, you can't prove the sacrificial love of the father without disobedience by the children. Because otherwise you're like, you only love me because I do what you want me to do. And sometimes, as you mentioned, the hard way. You have to learn the hard way. You have to learn what it's like, what it takes. And sometimes when that happens to someone else, you can view it so you don't have to experience the difficulty yourself. You can see the love reflected through the other person, because they're like, well, this is what happened. They've experienced it. I want some of that. And I spent most of my life thinking that God was pissed at me. Right? Because, I mean, in this scenario, I was like, yeah, I lied. I'm doing things I know you don't want me to do. I told you I'm going to Paris. Technically, I did, but I'm not staying in Paris. I'm going to go follow you two around Europe. And he knows that, but he doesn't tell her that she knows it, or that he knows it, right? Which I think it was super cool. Again, God knows what we're doing, even though we like to think we're hiding stuff. she can't be honest with you, right? Because she's afraid of the repercussions. As she's, you know, lying under the bed, he hears the conflict. He hears the struggle, how that must tear the father's heart, how that must tear the father's heart when we do things, as you say, when we choose other things. And he has to watch us going down this path that we chose for ourselves. Because like you said, he's going to let us choose for ourselves.
Yep.
And I always thought the clip I'm going to play, I always thought that those words were words for me. It's like, yeah, you're a screw up. I'm coming for you. I'm pissed at you. I told you this would happen. Because, you know, fathers will interact with children that way. And again, going back to the garden. When God shows up, who told you you were naked? Adam, where are you? It was not, I told you so. It was not, now what have you done? He wasn't surprised. He knew it was going to happen. But in this, I can't say conversation. It's the monologue. It's the you know, the monologue that's known, this movie is known for.
Yep.
But I want you to listen with the perspective of, this is not what God is saying to you. This is what God is saying to the enemy. This is what Jesus came down to do. And if you look at this as God's expression of his desire and pursuit of us in our hearts, I think it makes a lot, it becomes a lot more powerful than it already is.
If you are looking for ransom, I can tell you I don't have money. But what I do have are a very particular set of skills. Skills I have acquired over a very long career. Skills that make me a nightmare for people like you. If you let my daughter go now, that'll be the end of it. I will not look for you. I will not pursue you. But if you don't, I will look for you. I will find you. And I will kill you.
So there's two things that work together in this. And we've already talked about one of them, which is God is after our hearts, and he's after the person he created us to be. He's after that. Absolutely. At the same time, he is aware that there is an enemy who will kill us and enslave us at any possible moment. You know, and we've talked about this. You go back to the Halloween episode, or we've talked about this over a couple episodes. But just, I don't know that I've told this story on the podcast before, but my mentor, Larry Trammell, told me about a dream he had one night. Like, and this was while we knew each other. He said, I had a dream last night. And he, you know, it was spiritual. And he said, I came downstairs, and in the living room, there was a man, a handsome man in a suit, sitting in my living room. And I knew it was the devil. I knew that's who that was. And the devil looked at me and said, I would kill you if I could. I'd kill you if I could. He said, and then I woke up. And so we talked about it. You know, there's all sorts of layers of that dream, right? The devil can look appealing. The devil is handsome. The devil isn't. The Bible never says that the devil looks grotesque. That's part, because then it would be truthful. He's a deceiver, right? That would actually be truthful if he was grotesque, and he looked like a zombie or something. You know, like he's not, he's death, but
no,
he looks
pitchfork, no, yeah, no horns, no, and tail.
Doesn't have anything like that.
He's an angel of light, chief musician of heaven.
But and then he says, I would kill you if I could. So these are two things happening simultaneously. God is after us being the person he's created us to be that will give us the greatest amount of joy and contentment. That doesn't mean we'll be rich. That means we'll have joy and contentment, and we'll have relationship with him, and we will have the very unseen things that we long for. Now, at the same time, we have an enemy, and the Father knows that we have this enemy.
And so the Father warns us about paths that will lead us closer to this enemy. And so in this amazing speech, you see these two things working together. It's about saving his daughter, but he is absolutely certain there's an enemy out there, and he is absolutely willing to kill this enemy. I will take care of this enemy, period. I will. If you just leave me alone. And we were talking earlier before the podcast started, before we recorded, and I was like, the Bible doesn't say this. And I'm not going to put this in the Bible, but I wonder if God would say this to the devil. Like, if you just leave me and my people alone, I'll leave you alone. But the devil doesn't do that. The devil, evil doesn't make sense. Evil isn't about reason. It's not about intelligence. Right. If the devil was smart, he'd just be off on his own, doing his own thing. And he wouldn't mess with us at all. But that's not what he's doing. But I love that about the Father, is that he's also, and yet we live in a, we try to, especially in the Western culture, we try to sort of separate ourselves from death and tragedy and trauma. Like we don't want to admit openly that these very dark things happen, and that there is this sort of enemy. And that's why God does warn us, because he loves us, both for both of those reasons. Yes, he doesn't want us to die, but he also wants to give us the greatest life we've ever, more than we dream. She didn't even know he had this opportunity for her. Like, that's what God has for us.
Literally in his back pocket, because it was on a business card. One of the things that you had said struck me of, there was no condemnation. Just like Jesus said, I've not come to condemn the world, but to redeem the world, to set it free. He wasn't condemning Kim. He wasn't mad at Kim. His heart, anger, focus was on the enemy to set his daughter free. So looking at it from that perspective of the Father's pursuit of us, how does Brian's pursuit of Kim mirror and parallel that?
Jesus doesn't condemn us because we're already condemned. I mean, we are already condemned when he showed. Like, why is he condemning us? Like, I'm here because you're dead already. I'm here to give you life, and so why would he waste his time, like going to his daughter, going, I told you so. Like, why would he waste his time? Right. She knows it. She is very aware of the situation. And she's in pain, and so a God of love is like, well, that's just a waste of time, and I don't know. Well, I've talked about this before on this podcast and everywhere, but I know it might surprise people, but sometimes I do stuff that is wrong, and I feel bad.
What?
I know, and I go to God, and I expect him to go, man.
Yeah, you're going to have to give me a couple days. I'm not going to talk to you. I'm going to give you the silent treatment.
Like, I feel like I deserve some distance from him. I deserve some anger from him. I deserve some condemnation. Don't you just
headbutt me?
Something. But what I get is, I'm so glad you're back. I'm so glad you're back. Like, he doesn't have to tell me what I did was wrong. I knew it. Like, why are we going to belabor the point? The point of God's mission is to redeem and reconcile all creation back to himself through his son, Jesus Christ. That's what he's doing. And so part of that is recognizing our part in being sheep that have gone astray, each to our own way. Yes, we have to recognize that, but we also have to recognize if that's all we have, then we're stuck in slavery. We also have to realize that our Father is actively pursuing our hearts but also our lives. And so what I see from him is that he is willing to go to dark places, even though he is of the light. I'm talking about God. You know, we can get into the anti-hero element of Brian Mills in these movies, but kind of like the John Wick thing. But no, he's right. God is of light, and he's willing to go to dark places for us and redeem us out of those dark places. He's willing to go to great lengths. And it's also an urgent search. I know to us, things might seem like they take a while, but to God, there is an urgency. There is an urgency to this. And we are told several times in the New Testament, no, we don't know when it's all going to happen. You don't know if you're going to be alive tomorrow, right? You don't know. So cling to him, be aware, be awake, be sober-minded, be aware of your surroundings. All of those things that he wanted her to do, call me, let me know. Maybe I could go with you. I'm really good at being invisible. But no, I don't want you to go with me, because then I couldn't enjoy myself the way I want to.
Then you're going to know that I was lying to you.
And then you know I'm lying and all that. So, but my point is that, yes, there's no condemnation because we're already in it. We're already enslaved. Like, what is he going to condemn us for? What he's after is to save us from it. And he's doing it out of love. He's doing it out of compassion. He's doing it because what he wants is relationship. And there's an urgency to it. In his mind, there's an urgency to it. He doesn't, you know, if my son got arrested, I might let him spend the night in jail. But that's different than this very extreme sort of movie where her life is in danger.
Well, and she suffered the consequences of her actions. Granted, that wasn't her intended action.
No.
But to me, and I thought that what I saw was like, he is committed. You know, that whether you committed, relentless, persistent.
Yes.
Nothing's going to stop his pursuit of Kim. Yeah. And I'm not sure how this relates exactly, but he was willing to go through anyone. Like, it didn't matter. He was going to get to his daughter. And you mentioned the relational aspect, like the relationship was all that mattered to him. He didn't care about right or wrong. All this, you know, you shouldn't have done this. I told you none of that. It was relational to the core of he was pursuing his daughter. He would go through anything to restore their relationship. He had integrity. Because when he's on the phone for her, to her, he says, I will come for you. He warned her, you're going to get taken. This is going to happen. You are not stopping this. I can't stop it because I'm this far away. But I am going to rescue you. Which always surprises us when he actually does. Because we always feel abandoned, you know. How many times do we feel God's invisible? He's abandoned us, all this stuff.
Yeah.
So that when he shows up, we sort of respond like Kim does.
Kim.
You came for me. You came for me.
I told you I would.
Well, here's the biblical moment for that. Adam and Eve are cast out of the garden. It's a flaming sword put up in the way. Boom, here's the curse. But I'm sending someone.
Right.
The first moment, right? The first moment. Yes, they get the consequences, but within the consequences, and you're right, this is the whole Old Testament, every prophet. Man, you screwed up again. You're going to get these consequences, but
the Messiah is coming.
I'm coming. I'm going to redeem you. I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm going to help you. I'm going to save you. every time. Yeah, I'm going to let you get taken by these other nations. I told you this is what would happen. But then I'm going to bring you back. And when I bring you back this time, it's going to be forever. It's literally the whole Old Testament. And then Jesus
despite
comes.
How good Brian is, they get taken like two more times
all right.
in future movies.
Oh, they, you know, they had to make it's like John Wick. It's such a popular movie. You just got to keep, let's make another one. So, but to your point is that you're right, is that within, it wasn't condemnation. You're going to get the consequences. But within that first truth is I will come for you. And we may not believe it, and it may take a while.
Right.
But
right, because it's will. Not what we want,
right?
But it's how we grow.
Yeah.
And what we see as he goes to rescue her, he frees others along the way.
Yep. Good.
And so that to me brings us to our final point. We had mentioned I don't remember at this point if it was in before we hit record or after. But the whole point of Henry Nouwen wrote a book called The Prodigal Son, based on a painting, I think Rembrandt did, of the prodigal son, and then the story, obviously. But Henry Nouwen said, we must go through the process of being the prodigal son so that we can become the father. And we see at the end of the movie that Kim is rescued and then gets introduced to the pop star singer, the vocal coach, the manager there, because what the true invitation was revealed, who she really was. We are saved. She was saved for a purpose. Granted, being a pop star might seem kind of frivolous, but she wasn't called to follow a band around. She was called to lead a band, to be a singer, to be the one on stage. We are called not to follow the crowd, but to be a singer, to set others free, to pursue them in a way, in the same way that the Father pursues us.
She wanted to be a consumer. And I think that's the difference. She wanted to be a consumer, and God is calling us to be a participant, because that's how he knows our hearts will be fulfilled. Because he's on mission, and he's like, if you'll go on mission with me, helping others and participate in this. And like you said, that doesn't mean you have to go to Africa, but it's going somewhere. You are sent, just like
Jesus. It may be going to lunch with someone.
It might be going to lunch. It might be going to coffee. It might be going across the street. It might be several different things. But when we realize that being on mission with God is where we will find the most joy and contentment.
By the way, being on mission, maybe you take that crappy workplace you work at and you shine a light in it.
Yeah.
I mean, we're not saying you, no. It's not going to, it's bringing God to where you are and following his invitation to life.
Right.
Not setting the direction, setting your path. It's following his path, not your own.
Well, and that's starting where you are is always the first step. And that's a duh statement, but I want you to really hear what I said. Starting where you are is always the first step. A lot of times people feel called to be, we were talking about this before, I'm going to be a great author. I want to be a great movie producer or director or write great scripts. And it's like, and it seems so far away, and God's not calling you to that yet. God's like, no, just write a paragraph, right? Or whatever. Like, just make a little short video and learn this, and then you'll learn something mm-hmm. next. And he'll take you on that path. And just like, she wasn't promised to become a pop star. She said, we'll let you sing for the guy, and maybe, right? Like
we'll see if you have talent.
There are first steps. And so it's always starting with God. We expect God to give us big ministries, but we won't try to touch the people we work with. Like we don't try to love those people or our own families or whatever right. it might be, wherever he's given us influence right now, we're not going to bring the gospel to them first And yet we're like, oh no, but God wants me to in front of millions. It's like, no, he really doesn't probably, but he can't trust you with that because you don't care about the people you sit next to at lunch, at least in that way. And so therefore, yes, yeah, so that's what we're saying. We were saying being on mission with God is it's always starting where you are. It's always starting with what you know right where you are right now. And God will open the doors along the way, and it will be in things you never even dreamed. You don't know what it is 10 years from now. You have no clue. But it's not going to happen. 10 years from now isn't going to happen if we don't participate where we are. And so she, instead of being a consumer, he wanted, his invitation was for her to be a participant, put herself at risk, a different kind of risk. It was a different kind of risk. It wasn't a risk with the enemy. It was a risk of, will they like me? Will they reject me? Will they, right? That's what we risk when we try to tell people
the gospel. Well, even Brian risked in the very beginning. He's like, I know this, you know, the singer's going out on to go out on stage. He's like, I know this is probably a bad time. My daughter has a,
right.
She wants to be a singer. Like right. He puts himself out there, as you said, at risk of rejection of, and sort of gets it. She's like, don't. Okay, thanks. That's super helpful.
Right. And also just as a whole other sort of conversation we could have, well, maybe not a whole other conversation, but he got the opportunity for his daughter by rescuing others. Like right. we don't know, like when we start doing this, you don't know what God's got for you because he can trust you with it. He's like, oh, it's about others. Okay. Now we can do this. Now we can, you know, I was watching, you guys didn't bring all this stuff when you guys did Nacho Libre. We were watching Nacho Libre the other night, and that's when it turned for Nacho. When he finally said, look, if I win, I'm going to buy the bus and I'm going to take the orphans to the parks and the things and the right. Then he becomes the amazing fighter he always wanted to be. That's when he became the person, is when he, you know, and he was being generous before, but it stopped being about just fame and started saying, you know what? I just want to help people with this.
And well, so, and even going, if we go back farther in the story on this little side trail, it's the opportunity, Brian's opportunity started when his friend invited him to join.
Yes.
Hey, I have an opening. And again, you know, if we sort of extrapolate and go real meta, he followed the invitation that he received. He said yes. He's like, oh, it's here. It's local. I'm not giving up time with my daughter. I'm still available, all this stuff. Yeah, I can say yes to this invitation, which opened up the invitation. You know, as you said, he rescued the pop star. So then that changed her perspective and said, here, she reached out, but it all started with his friend's invitation.
I love it.
And that's where our mission starts. Just whether we're Kim or Brian, there will be an invitation from God to do something that might be uncomfortable, that might not be exactly the direction that we wanted, but it leads to a revelation of who we truly are, of who we're truly called to be. And will lead to not just the freedom, greater freedom in our own lives, but freedom in the lives of the people around us.
Amen.
So this has been Paul McDonald and Britt Mooney talking about Taken. And I hope you enjoyed it. And I hope you guys join us next time here on the Men at the Movies podcast.
Something inside has been awakened. I can no longer be who I was before. But if I am no longer who I was, who am I to be?